Hi, this is Vicky. Welcome to the Profit Builder. I want to talk with you today about accounting fraud. And I want to talk to you about this subject because I notice in this time when so many of us are doing way more things remotely, people are working from home, it is often easy for us to forget to make sure that we have good controls in place to avoid the risk and the liability of money going out that really shouldn't be going out of our business. And I specifically mean people really stealing money from your business. And it's not as hard to happen as you actually might think. And what I've done today is I created a PowerPoint that I'm gonna walk you through and just talk to you about what are some of the ways that that could possibly happen. What are some of the things that you can do to avoid it? And at the end, I'm going to share with you 10 ways to spot accounting fraud in your business. So let me go in and share my screen. Some of the things that I hear business owners say are things like, well, you know, the bookkeeper knows more about this stuff than I do, so I'm not even sure what to look at. Or they've been doing this for years. Of course, they couldn't possibly be dishonest. How could I possibly mistrust them? Or they're a relative. Of course, I can trust them. And I want you to know that I have seen people be embezzled from who have done this job for many, many years. I've seen people get embezzled money by family members. I have seen people who have been embezzled from because they've just completely abdicated responsibility, assuming, hey, I don't know how to do that stuff, that person does. And while you don't have to know how to do the accounting, like how to pay that federal tax bill or how to file that quarterly report or cut that payroll check or, cut that vendor check, you do need to make sure that you've got controls in place in order to avoid people from taking advantage of and stealing money from you. And, sometimes it can happen in the most innocent of ways. And sometimes it can be in ways that you just wouldn't even think. Like, here are some examples. Using the company credit card for personal use. Now, you might not think of this as embezzling, but here's a funny thing that I have found over the years is that when your employees start charging personal things to their credit card and you never pay attention to it, they somehow in their brain, as crazy as this sounds, almost think like, well, you must think of that as like a perk of the job. They bought extra tools. They bought extra materials to do their home project or a weekend project that they're doing. I had one bookkeeper who was paying the liability insurance for her boyfriend's construction business through the company on the credit card. Or she had charged some personal tickets to the business credit card for a concert that she was going to. It didn't have to be a big thing, but people get into this habit of, well, it must be okay because nobody's said anything. So one of the other things is processing extra payroll checks. I've seen this happen. We had a situation where a client had hired this bookkeeper. She had 20, 30 years experience. She was very experienced and very well qualified, had worked in construction for all those years, had come with good references, was brought to us from a headhunter. Within about 4 months, things started showing up and we discovered she was processing extra payroll checks that she had put through the system under somebody else's name, but then put her name on it, changed her name, and then cashed the checks. And she actually had them on direct deposit directly from the bank account. She also started to write checks to another business from within the company as a separate vendor. And before we knew it, within like 6 months, she had embezzled $250,000. Now, we were fortunate that it got caught because there were some controls in place. But even at that, it took too long as far as I'm concerned. And this was somebody with a lot of experience and who was highly qualified to do really a great job. So you just never know, you want to be careful and that is, you know, the extra payroll is one of the ways that she had stolen money. The next one is paying personal credit cards with company funds. I did this workshop several years ago on fraud for a bank. And the night before I was going in to do it, there was a big article in the local newspaper that a contractor had been embezzled for $1 million from their bookkeeper of 30 years. This was a woman who had worked for them, obviously, for a lot of years, had completely, totally trusted her because she was like a family member. Well, what come to find out, she had been charging personal charges to paying her personal credit card through the business. And she was paying it online, so nobody ever noticed. But over 10 years, it was nearly $1 million. So it's a really simple thing, but it was like a down payment on a car. She remodeled her house, but like she wasn't telling anybody about these things. And I don't even remember how they found out about it. But it's as simple as something as she was just simply paying her personal credit card through the business account. Making up and paying fictitious vendors. So this was an example of this other bookkeeper I mentioned a minute ago who had set up a vendor for a fictitious business and started writing checks to that vendor. And the business owner was not paying any attention to who the vendors were when he was signing checks because he wasn't looking at backup to see, well, who had authorized that payment, what job was it on, and so on. She just was making them up. Another one, voiding AR invoices and delivering payment, diverting payments. I've seen this happen as well, where a bookkeeper would get a check in for a client and she would void the receivable invoice in the system. And then the check had a name of a their business that was very close to another bank account this bookkeeper had set up, that it was close enough that the bank didn't question the fact that it was a different business. She had literally set up a fictitious business name filing, opened up a bank account and the whole thing just so that she could start diverting funds. Another one, transferring transfer to personal account. So they actually were doing transfers to a personal account and create, you know, causing fraud that way. So those are just some examples of ways that people can embezzle from you really easily. And in today's environment, there are so many more opportunities to do that as we become more automated in what we do in terms of bookkeeping and accounting. So how do you minimize your risk and liability? So a couple of things I would suggest is one, have solid processes in place around who approves costs and who gets to spend money. And make sure that all of those invoices have some way of getting, reflecting that they have been approved for payment, whether that's a project manager on a job, an operations manager, the owner, the CFO, like be clear about who's got spending limits for how much and what requires additional approval. And make sure that when payments get made to those vendors, you're looking at all of that backup to verify that those things have been done, those approvals have been made. Another one, review all payroll before it's issued. This is a huge area where I see a lot of people completely miss the boat. They just go, oh, payroll, it just all gets processed in there. Some companies, like everybody's on direct deposit, and you never look at the payroll. Look at payroll. Look at it when time cards, you know, are going in, have an approval. And again, this comes down to processes, right? Who's approving those number of hours and what the payroll is. And then before the button gets hit to pay out that payroll, that you're reviewing the payroll journal or the payroll ledger and going, you know, yes, I know that person, there's not any extra employees on there. There's no duplicate payroll checks. Having those controls in place is critical. And then the third one is when you sign checks or hit the pay button, make sure that you're reviewing the backup, right? Make sure that you know what you're agreeing to pay for. You know, when it was one of the things that I've taught every client I've ever worked with this, when you go to sign a check, look at the backup. There's only two sources of outside documentation that ever comes into your business to let you know if your books are accurate. One of them is your bank statements, which I'm going to talk about in a second. The second one is vendor statements. So when vendor statements come in, they should reconcile with what's in your books. And if they don't, you want to ask questions why. You want to dig deeper. If the vendor shows you owe all this money, but you don't show that you owe nearly that much money, did those funds get diverted? Is something, you know, are you ruining your credit? Are payments not getting made? Is something being missed? Or if you're paying way more than the statement shows, why? Or if there's backup that doesn't match with what that check says, why? Right? Is it approved? So looking at that backup, and it's got a couple fold really valuable things for you. One of it is certainly to make sure that the books are matching with what that outside source documentation says and that you know that it's more accurate. But secondly is it gives you an opportunity to see where people are spending and wasting money in amazing ways. And that includes looking at credit card statements, reviewing those credit card statements and going, you know, does that make sense? You know, if I'm looking at also at either a vendor statement or a credit card statement, and I see I got a guy in the field who's running to Home Depot three times a day, I'm going to ask some questions. And the thing that I have found that, you know, there's really a double fold benefit when you start to ask questions, people notice that you're paying attention. And when they notice that you're paying attention to how they're spending your money, they're going to have a tendency to be more cautious and pay more attention and be more mindful. So if you don't say anything, people just assume that whatever their behavior is okay. And it's not. So some other ways to minimize and risk a liability is have somebody independent reconcile the bank account. And when I say reconcile, I mean that two things. One, does the bank ending balance in your reconciliation report match with the system? Two, that there's not items outstanding for more than 6 months for checks. And if it's a deposit, there should never be anything outstanding. That means the deposit didn't make it to the bank. So those are some of the things, but having somebody independent, so whether that's, you know, a business owner, maybe it's you, maybe it's your accountant, maybe it's an outside advisor, but have somebody else review and reconcile the bank account. That's a really good practice because, again, remember, bank account, only the second and other outside source document that you get from somewhere outside of your business that comes into you to let you know that your books are accurate. So it's also a place where things will show up and that it's just a good checks and balance system to make sure that there's controls in place. And then the other thing I mentioned earlier, reconcile vendor statements. And the other key thing I would say minimizing risk and liability is have all tax notices come to the owner before they get opened. I'll tell you an example of, and this wasn't necessarily being embezzled from, but there was a bookkeeper who had not, well, actually, I think that he was embezzling now that I think about it. He was not paying the tax payments, but the money was coming out of the bank account. And so the notices started to pile up, but the business owner never saw it. And then for a series of events, I don't know if he quit or if he got fired, then all of this sort of came to light. And it took them months and months and months to unravel what had actually, you know, been paid, not been paid. And then, you know, to find out how much had been diverted out of the company that should have been paid to payroll taxes. It's just payroll taxes is a place where you have a huge liability, right, and risk. So you don't want to take that chance. So some things to never do. You never want to abdicate financial management responsibility. And when I say abdicate, I mean that thing where we go, oh, that person knows more about that stuff than I do. You need to have a relationship with the financial stuff in your business. It doesn't mean you have to do the mechanics. I think having somebody else do the mechanics is super important. You just need to manage the result. And that's true for every position in your business and certainly your money. And assume that you know them well and they won't, don't assume that you know them well and that they'll not embezzle. I've seen family members embezzle. I know a sister-in-law who was embezzling from a company. Don't ignore problems when they arise or ignore tips from other employees. Those are some of the ways, you know, when you start to get some red flags, there's usually something more that you want to look into. And I'm going to share with you, this is a great resource that I came across many years ago, and it's called 10 Steps to Spotting Accounting Fraud. I'm actually going to bring it up on the screen so that you can see it. And it goes through and it says, you've got somebody who never wants to go on vacation. I have to tell you, this has been one that I've seen, that the people who have embezzled are usually the ones that are very protective. And they're like, oh, I'm the only person who can handle this. They always have more work than they can possibly get finished during a day. So they have to work over hours, which means that then they're in the office when nobody can see what they're doing. A tattletale likes to point out incompetencies of other employees, volunteers to take care of details that should be handled by a principal. You can read this in more detail. I'm just going to do the highlights. Likes to pick up the mail, even if it makes no sense. Acts like bookkeeping tasks are difficult, and it's brain surgery. I've seen that one too. It's like, oh, it's too complicated, I can't explain it. Don't ever accept that as an answer from your finance person. Acts like bookkeeping, I just said that one, tells little fibs. This is definitely an indication. I have seen this as a habit. The one bookkeeper that was paying her boyfriend's liability insurance bill through the credit card, there were just like little things, and it kind of added up after a while. But she was lying about little things that she was lying about. Seems to feel that the company owes some something, as if he has done more than could be expected of any reasonable person. Prints in precise, tidy letters, but can't seem to find the things on their desk when you ask them. And volunteers to take on things that, like interfacing with the auditors, personally making police reports or IRS correspondence. I have to tell you that when I saw this, and this has still been true every year since I first found this, that when I have seen accounting fraud, usually some or all of these flags are true. So this might be something that you want to check out. I'm including a link here in the, I'm including a link there on the PowerPoint, but I'm also including a link on this post. So I hope you found this to be helpful, and that you'll take from here to implement some things in your business to help reduce your risk and liability. And I'm not saying, you know, treat your bookkeeper like they're a bad person or assume that they're dishonest, but it's really about you putting controls in place as a leader and a business owner to make sure that you're safeguarding the assets of your business and that you're staying connected with where and how your money is getting spent. Feel free to email me or drop a note in the blog if you have something else to add to the topic.